time it is? Does anybody really care? If so, I can't imagine why. We've all got time enough to cry. And I was walking down the street.
Of destruction, baptisms of fire. I've witnessed your suffering as the battle raged high. And in the fear and alarm, you did not desert me, my brothers and I. Thank you.
I'd like to welcome out all the family and friends and colleagues and students, all those that knew Mike in some way, out to this wonderful service that we have today to honor, remember, and cherish the life of Michael James Sellers, who was born on June 29th, 1961, and passed from this world on June 27th of 2022. We'd like to thank both George and Janet Harris for providing the prelude music for us today. And also thank all those that are joining online, and also those that are here in person. To accommodate those that are traveling, a request for those that, if you can, there are masks available outside for anyone that would like one. And also one reminder about LDS, or Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints services, is that we'll have beautiful musical numbers just like this prelude that we just had. And what's unique is that we actually don't applaud after these musical numbers, so we don't want to appear that we're ungrateful, but we can very much thank them after the service. But just so you're not caught off guard or wonder why no one's clapping, that is the reason why. My name is Bishop Donnie Young. Also on the stand with me is Jason Francis from our stake presidency. He will be presiding over today's meeting. Our opening prayer will be provided by Gene Bavender, and then we will proceed with the remainder of the program, as you'll see outlined on that first page. And then I will come up again to close at the conducting.
Our dear Heavenly Father, as we gather this evening to honor and remember Mike Sellers, please bless us that we will take all the good that he showed us and be able to apply it in our lives. Help us now to be comforted and rejoice in the wonder of his life. And again, bless us all that we may have thy spirit to be with us always and thy guidance and protection. And these things we say in thy beloved Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen.
Mike Sellers described himself as a game designer, professor, artificial intelligence researcher, father and grandfather, not necessarily in that order. He touched many lives throughout his decades of leadership and service to his family, his church, the video game development industry, and the Indiana University community. Born on June 29, 1961, Mike attended the International School in Manila, Philippines, and Lewis and Clark College in Portland, Oregon. At Lewis and Clark, he discovered a love for cognitive science, and he went on to build his career around artificial intelligence. Over 37 years, he created computer games and virtual worlds, founded multiple companies, and shepherded dozens of projects into existence, including the landmark online role-playing game Meridian 59. In 2014, he came to Indiana University to help found the game design program at the Media School. As a professor of practice and director of the program, he imparted his decades of experience to the next generation of game creators. His advanced game design textbook has become a core component of university programs across the country. Throughout his adult life, Mike was a devoted member of The Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, serving as an elder, high priest, Sunday school teacher, and frequent Boy Scout leader. His commitment to teaching and mentoring informed every aspect of his life. He is survived by his wife of 42 years, Joanna, his six children and their partners, his six grandchildren, and his five siblings and their partners, as well as many other family members, friends, colleagues, and students. He will be greatly missed, but he leaves behind a legacy of showing genuine love and care for those with whom he associated, and we can honor his life by doing the same.
My name is Terry, and I'm Mike's sister. oldest of the six kids, so it's me and then five brothers. Mike was the second youngest brother, and he was very imaginative, very creative. He loved wearing a cape around the house and carrying his favorite stuffed animal, Trunky. Our dad used to tell us Jeffrey and Scott stories at bedtime, mostly stories about two young lion cubs who went who went on adventures. I really think that Mike loved these stories and later used his own imagination and creativity to create fantasies of his own. In high school, Mike was sort of a ladies' man. He had those dreamy eyes that made it easy to meet girls until he met Joanna, of course. And then it was all over. After high school, Mike came and visited me in Michigan, but lived with a bunch of friends, a bunch of guys. They were not a frat house, but wonderful guys. But then he got a job at a pickle factory. And these wonderful guys made him change outside because he smelled so bad when coming in. After that, he went off to school. And later on, my husband and I went out to visit them in Oregon. I always sort of struggled to put together a month's worth of recipes, and then only to find out that Mike and Joe had like 2 years of food in their house, which I understand can be normal for some people, but definitely not me. I was pretty impressed. We had a lot of things in common with Mike and Joe. We shared a love of Disney, love storytelling, and family. We didn't go quite as far as they did. They had six kids. We had two. But Mike was definitely known for pulling everybody else in with him when he told his stories. I think it is his love of storytelling and his great, deep love of family that helps me to understand why so many people called him Papa Mike. I will always remember him as a fun little brother that I will miss terribly.
Want to see here? My brother Mike had a heart of oak. Heart of oak, some of you may know, is the official march of the Royal British Navy, performed since the mid-19th century. Its title refers both to the wood that was used to build those mighty ships and to the hearts of the sailors in them, hearts like Mike's. Mike was a great fan of the Aubrey Matron books, novels that are set during the Napoleonic War. In fact, his family has had a dog named Aubrey and a dog named Maturin to honor those books. And the mariner spirit lived within Mike. When we were kids in the Philippines, he and his friend Dave used to go down to the Manila Yacht Club. Neither of them was a member. We were not members. And they would stroll in confidently, take out one of the catches or the other boats there and sail it around on Manila Bay and then come back, dock it, put everything away and just walk right back out. They did that all the time. I'm Steve. As Terry mentioned, I'm the second of the six children and the oldest of the boys. And Mike was 18 months younger than I am. And we were just 1 year apart in school, which meant that in high school there was sometimes some friction. But I left for college 1 year, and Mike followed me to California for college the next year. I lived in Northern California, he lived in Southern California. And he came up to visit me in the summer after my freshman year when he had first arrived. And we found ourselves together in the United States, away from the rest of the family. And all the sources of friction that had existed before simply vanished. And we recognized the close friends that we had always been, but it had sometimes had a hard time seeing. I'm so grateful for that. Several years later, after we had both gotten out of college and had embarked on different professional lives, Mike called me with some ideas for starting a couple of businesses, including his big idea, designing and building, as we've already heard, Meridian 59, which was the first of what we now call massively multiplayer online games, or MMOs. I still remember him taking me down to his basement in his Oregon house when he was first trying to explain to me what this idea was. And he had this SGI Indy down there, very expensive computer. I'm not to this day quite sure how he managed to buy that thing or hold on to it. And he turned it on and he showed me these two little blobs that looked like Hostess snow cones, that what they call it? Anyway, this Hostess snowballs. And they were moving around and I thought, oh, that's really interesting, nice graphics. And he said, no, someone on the East Coast is moving those things and we're watching it here. And that was the birth of the World Wide Web. But what Mike was conceptualizing, what the great leap forward was how to make a massively multiplayer online game out of this, with avatars representing the people in the communities online. He was a true visionary. He was well ahead of where everyone else was, thinking ahead, thinking several times around the block ahead of everyone else. And I was both fascinated and delighted to join him on this ride into the future. Archetype Interactive, the company we started to produce Meridian 59, was the second of three companies that we founded and worked on together. We had to write the plan. We had to go pitch venture capitalists. I was living in the Bay Area. Mike was living in Oregon. He would get on a plane. We'd have a pitch to do. He'd get on a plane. He'd load up his full pillar processor and a monitor and keyboard and accessories, hop on that plane. I drive up to the airport, pick him up. We take all this stuff out of bubble wrap, drive over to the offices of the VCs and pitch them. I also remember that once we got Meridian 59 launched, it took off, and it was very popular, especially in certain communities. And at one point, we even watched as in the game we hosted an online wedding. Two people who were not even in the United States were getting married in the game in Meridian 59, and that's what those hostess snow cones had become. They'd gone from these kind of blobs on a screen, and now there were people involved with this, and it was phenomenal. Mike's move here to Indiana was a great cap to many years of work in online gaming, giving him the chance to share his decades of experience and expertise with students and with colleagues. It was just a great place for him to come. Over the last few years, since our father died, Mike also came to occupy within me a place that I don't think I understood was so important until I realized it was going to be going, and I was going to lose it. As I may now, he had become a steady, calm place of assurance to me, the strongest board taken from that heart of oak. I depended on his strength for my support. He and I were different, very different, as we always had been, yet he was also an integral part of my own makeup. I'm so grateful to have had him so embedded in me, where he became part of my core, that true heart of oak. It's hard to lose, and really, really impossible to replace. I also just want to take a minute to say a few words about Joanna, Mike's wife, companion, confidant, support. We've all seen the pictures for more than four decades. Count high school, I think it's actually getting close to five decades. I first met her when they were both very young, and I've been in and out of their lives ever since. Mike and I discussed our wives and our families a lot, including what to do when we screwed up, or for me at least, needed advice. And I can remember Mike helping me when I was having trouble once, telling me that he and Joe had kind of come to this understanding that every day that they remained together was a success. That day's victory and worth celebrating, just one day at a time. But you know, Mike was a devout member of the LDS Church, and he knew in his heart that he and Joanna would be together forever, but he also still knew that marriages require work. And he shared that wisdom with me. This last year has been hard for all of us, and hardest for Joanna. She's an incredible source of strength and grace. I love her for her humor, her resourcefulness, and her profound loyalty and support. And what she's done, what she was able to do to help Mike this past year is extraordinary. She's a true hero. I miss Mike, and I always will. I hope that I can work to treasure and to understand the gifts that he's given to all of us. Like many of you, I'm having a little trouble here. Like many of you, I fully expected and looked forward to growing old with my younger brother, to looking back with him and reflecting on our lives and on our adventures, and to sharing plans for new ones. We won't get that chance now, but I hope that his departure from us will bring us all closer, and that we will celebrate with and in each other what we celebrated in Mike, his intelligence and wit, his deep caring for everyone, regardless of where people came from, his wisdom and his love. I hope that I and we can work to embody those qualities and to learn from them. I hope our loss helps us to come together and to realize our deep strengths and the deep strengths that Mike has left us, and that we understand when we look to each other and express them in our own lives, what those strengths are and what gifts Mike has given us. I hope that we can be that heart of oak for each other as he was for me.
Good evening. I am Professor Ted Castronova, the representative here, I guess, from Indiana University. This was a brilliant man, and I'm so grateful to all of you who knew him for sharing him with us for a few years. It's hard to express how smart Mike is, because as you all know, he was humble. He was not one of these type of people. But I came to know really quickly how deep this man's brain went, and I'll share an anecdote about that. As I got to know him in the process of recruiting, but also seeing him, you know, at game development conferences and so on, I noticed he had this unusual power. I don't know if it was his superpower, it was among them. He could connect to anyone at any time about anything. And it became so regular that I would overhear him in these conversations about, you know, the design of nuclear submarines or something with an expert in that field, that I started to sort of rely on it as a recruiting tool for other people. I'd say, you know, anytime I wanted to impress people about what we were doing or try to get someone to come, I would sort of pull them aside before they met Mike, and, you know, people would be mingling. Oh, he was a great mingler. I really envy him that. And I would say, now watch this. Within 5 minutes, Mike is going to be connecting to, you know, that person over there on some area of that person's specialty. So in other words, I would go out on a limb and predict it. And this one time in particular, you know, we sat there and we watched, and he starts talking to the person, you know, introduced and so on. And they just started to discuss their early life. And this fellow, Michael, said, well, you know, when I started out, I was a telescope operator. And Mike immediately popped up with digital or optical. And off they went. Talk, you know, again, it was a thing I had no idea. But he just kept doing that over and over again. And you know from seeing the background of him, how many places he could have gone with that brain of his. And we're just very grateful he brought it here. And so I can assure you all, on behalf of the university, that this man's legacy will continue here indefinitely. He brought tremendous treasures to Indiana University, and we've used that treasure to plant some things, and we already see it growing. Thank you.
when we were kids, our dad put up a poster of Disneyland, the map of Disneyland. And he'd hidden a couple staples in the map itself, in a straight line, in the railroad or somewhere else. And Mike knew where they were right away, and he didn't tell me where they were, but he sort of led me to discover them. And it was very exciting. And, you know, from meeting Mr. Lincoln, the Pirates of the Caribbean, Dumbo, before the teacups, they had this, like, levitating thing. It was so cool, like air hockey. And he knew how that worked. And early on, he said, I want to be an Imagineer. And as a younger brother with a critical eye, I was ready to always find fault with him. But I really, truly believed then and all throughout that Disney would be so well off if they did get him as an Imagineer. Because I knew always, I remember we were very, very young at the OMSI, Oregon Museum of Science and Industry. And there was some cool little wire thing that was spinning around by itself magically. And they said, does anyone here know how it works? And it's ions. It's a little ion engine. And I was like, what's an ion? I mean, I was very young, but I didn't know what an ion was for another 10 years, really. And then later on, he told me about how, yeah, you could have an ion engine and fly rockets through space. And I was like, wow. And when he was in high school, he spent hours making one out of clay. And it was a, you know, actual like Atlas rocket. And inside, you couldn't see it, but I saw him as he was making it. He had put in all the parts, all the sub-stages and electronics and things all throughout that. And my mother took a picture of him. And I remember thinking, he's in high school, and he's like a little kid, so proud. But I knew that he had all the facts inside that imaginative rendering of a real-life thing. And I knew that he was a, you know, inventor of mansplaining, and knew that at the white shag carpet at the beach was an indoor-outdoor carpet, because that's what you would have, you know. But I also knew that his imagination was always backed up with facts, and he was someone I could go to and trust to give me the straight dope on stuff. As life has gone on, it's been so great to see how he really has succeeded in integrating himself and delivering for others a kind of living product. And his eclectic excellence, from the classical to the contemporary, his professional, personal manner that has reached so many people. If you haven't seen that Zoom virtual wake, an hour and a half of very painful crying and beautiful testimonies of the ripples and waves of goodwill and generative, life-affirming and giving. That's so great. So yeah, he really gave his full sense of self to everyday life, you know, quotidian, but not commonplace, not pedestrian. So as a student of psychology, Mike knew about conditioned response, about the relative lack of free will we have, about the importance of priming, about guiding ourselves and looking for guidance. And as a devout guy, he knew that it's all about becoming. We hope, we trust, we pray to become better. And this guy did. He really, you know. In psychology, there are different kinds of memory, right? We learn explicit memory, and then after a long time, our explicit memories can become implicit memories. And we have things we learn implicitly in the first place. And it was neat to see in the last year, you know, where we go to the doctor, and he had learned implicitly that you have to go to this desk over here to turn the card in, and we go down to this room down here. He had learned that because he cared, and he was there, and he cared about his brother Charles. He knew where he was in the world, even though he might forget what day it was or month. And so this building of self is grounded in, of course, his family. I mean, it's been said over and over again. It's so true. Steve, I just thank you so much for saying it so well about Joanna and all his family. And he, you know, knew that growth comes from pruning and how we need to prune parts, nurture parts. And he did that. He became wise. He wouldn't want to cuss right now like I do. I was talking to him, how do I do this without saying, because that's my first response. He had that buffer between stimulus and response, or reflex. He said, B.F. Skinner, you know, read between the lines, I'm going to have a choice, and I'm going to choose the caring, the non-condemning. And in the last year and a half, thank goodness, I once offered some caring word and attention, and he said, yes, please. And I asked him for advice, and he gave me great advice, like Joanna said earlier. The wisdom was there, and he had grown into this kind of a sanctified guy. I mean, really, I think. That's why I wear a mask, like a feed bag. Seriously, though, it's a word that I don't want to use lightly. But in the process of becoming, I believe Mike was well on the way, on the road of sanctification. And he deserves to hear the words, servant, well done. God bless me. Thank you all.
Oh, ooh. Oh yeah. Rock and roll. Oh yeah, cool
music. Well, I have to follow my Uncle John, who is always a tough act to follow, but we've structured things so that we have something like that that'll make you cry, and then a little something lighter, or a bit of music, and this time it's both. So, share a little story with you, and then we'll go into a song. When I was 13, my dad taught me to play poker, playing Ritz crackers. My dad taught me to play poker with Ritz crackers as betting chips. It certainly wasn't the first time that he sat down with me to share his love of games, and it wouldn't be the last. But it was the only time he started eating the game tokens when he realized that I'd mastered the rules a bit too quickly. My earliest memory of video games is sitting on his lap sometime in the 1980s as he taught me to play Dungeon of Doom on our little black and white Macintosh computer. The original Sid Meier Pirates on the Commodore 64 followed a few years later, and between the two, they laid a foundation for my lifelong love of video games. In 2003, in the same month I turned 22, I convinced my dad to take me on as his apprentice in making games. From then until my chronic illness forced me to retire at the end of 2010, I worked with him on all sorts of projects, and in many ways I was his first game design student, the guinea pig for the concepts he would go on to teach at IU. He gifted me with a box of Online Alchemy business cards that listed my title as Sorcerer's Apprentice. The song my siblings and I are about to sing was first introduced to me by my dad just a few months before I took that health sabbatical that would eventually turn into retirement, September 26, 2010. I know the exact date because I still have the chat log. For many, many years, my dad and I spoke primarily over chat every single day, all day long, work or anything else. And on September 26, 2010, he sent me a link to this song with a comment, "I think this could work as a theme for Frontier." Frontier was designed as a town-building game set on the edge of the historical American West, a perennial favorite of Dad's that we returned to over and over throughout the years I worked with him. It was meant to be populated by the artificial intelligence he conceived of called DynaMotion, AI that had emotional connections to each other, who built up a web of reputation on which to judge their fellow agents. Much of my early game development work with him was focused on that AI, in a shabby little office in Austin, whose primary recommending feature was that it was next door to a Sonic. In those early days, we had only three agents living together in a tiny digital world, aptly named Adam, Eve, and Stan. Dad and I were working together one afternoon in that terrible office, the DynaMotion simulation running on my computer, when Stan simply disappeared from the world right in front of my eyes. I exclaimed in surprise, and Dad came over to try to figure out what had happened. Looking at the logs, we discovered that Adam and Eve had, for complex AI reasons, decided unprompted that they just didn't like Stan. And since Stan had no social utility to him, they found a better use for him. They ate him. That moment of artificial cannibalism was perhaps not the part of the American historical West that Dad was hoping to recreate with Frontier, but we never did forget Stan, eaten too soon, much like my Ritz cracker poker chips.
Bye. Thanks, Brother Chris. Mike was an adventurer of many kinds. To me, he was like a wizard or an astronomer, a constellation maker, naming stars and finding patterns among them, connecting them, proving they're more than just a sea of random lights. In the early 90s, when I lived near Mike in Oregon, we often found ourselves in the car together, and we would talk along the way to wherever we were going. Our conversations unspooled without much direction, but full of enthusiasm, powered by soda pop. We went deep down rabbit holes and laughed at how many parentheses we found ourselves inside. By the mid-2000s, we had drifted apart, but a love of making games brought me back closer to him. And in about 2009, we started having those long talks again, with more direction this time. A few years ago, Mike set up a Discord server where he and I could talk about games that we were working on in hopes that we might finish some of them. I cherish the server. It's a treasure trove. If I could wish for anything, it's that I might have spent my time there talking less and listening more. He had such a deep reservoir of knowledge, and I want to hoard every scrap of his perspective, which I won't see again. In 2020, he and I started getting together on Memorial Day weekends to talk about games. He found an Airbnb roughly midway between Bloomington and Columbus. We called it I-70 Con. That was the road that connected us. I feel so lucky to have had that time in conversation with him where I could benefit from his vision. Mike saw farther than anyone I knew. His imagination was idealistic, patient, ethereal, and empyrean. He believed deeply in a recursive order to the universe, as if God had included each of us in an enormous, infinitely finely drawn M.C. Escher drawing. Mike sought to recapitulate that order in his own creations, and he had the depth and clarity of thought to do it. Compared to him, I'm cynical and impatient. But I want to live in the universe that he saw, intricately ordered and beautiful, like a brilliant cut gem. I wish I could see it the way he did, from way up on high, where its reflected complexity resolves into a unified whole of beautiful simplicity. He was unceasingly supportive of my creative ideas, and I'll always be grateful for it. That never changed from way back in the 90s to now. Just 2 weeks before he died, he wanted to make sure I was doing okay in my work and that I was happy. Given his mind, brain cancer seemed like a really cruel way to go. Why couldn't he have had more time at play in his thoughts? But his illness brought out another side of him, his serenity. He wasn't afraid of whatever might come. He knew, after decades of practice, that he was right where he needed to be. His life, like his sense of game design, had resolved into a unified whole. I'm going to want to tell him about things I find on the beach, or ideas I have on a walk, and I won't be able to. It's not right that he's not here. Going on without him seems somehow wrong. I miss his love of beauty. I miss his mind that made all these connections and saw all these constellations and took such joy in telling others about them. I'm going to go on, and I'm going to remember him in just about everything I do. Goodbye, Mike.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Norbert Herber. I was one of Mike's colleagues at IU in the media school. Mike and I stepped into leadership positions at IU at the same time. I became the director of our larger faculty group, and Mike became the game design director. And in those new positions, we both felt outgunned. It was a lot to take on, and spent a lot of time talking about what we would do for our students, what we'd do for our faculty colleagues, how can we improve all their lives and make this a better experience for everyone. But as we, I'll include myself in this, tended to do, we didn't always stay on topic. And a lot of times our conversations would shift to work that we were excited about. And Mike and I both had a love of systems and systems design. We both really admired the work of the Chilean biologist Humberto Maturana and Francisco Varela. They both had this cybernetic look at the way that living systems operate, and we would just geek out endlessly about that. Mike from the side of game design and, you know, thinking about characters and economies moving in different ways, and I was thinking about it in terms of music, melodies and harmonies colliding and coming together in different ways in the musical landscape. And I really miss those conversations and regret that I never had a chance to really share any of that music with Mike, because even though he said to me that I don't understand music, he knew a lot, and he would have been able to hear it, and I would have loved to have got his take on how all of this happened, and he would have wanted to look at the code and understand how it's working, what's really going on, and he would have given me great advice about how to add feedback loops to make it sound better. That's just the way he was. So I asked Joanna if I could play something at this service. This saxophone, the first time I ever played it in public was exactly 1 year ago today. I went to a park in town. I was gonna play a concert with some friends. Rare quiet before the storm of the new semester. And Mike called and told me about his diagnosis. And I was floored. He was characteristically positive, and we talked about all the things that we would do to help him get the treatment that he needed and make sure his highest priority was to make sure students got what they needed and that their experience in school wasn't ruined or set back in any way. And I'm just glad to be able to share this with you. Pagliasso is by Egberto Gismonti. He's a Brazilian composer. The title translates as The Clown, and it's one of the most beautiful songs I've ever played, and I always think about it in terms of Mike, and he would say, you know, in the game design program, we take our work seriously, but we don't take ourselves too seriously, and I think that title is appropriate for this. Thank you. Thank you.
adventurer, brother, father, colleague, boss, pioneer, visionary, teacher, seeker, artist, pirate captain. I'm Charles or Chuck, the youngest of the six siblings. And those are some of the many ways that I saw and experienced my brother Mike at various points throughout my life. When I was a young boy in the late 1970s, my 10-year older brother was an intriguing mystery. He seemed to be on his own path, as though he already knew what it meant to be the sorcerer's apprentice, and he wanted to find out how to become the wizard. I remember being perhaps six and Mike showing us a prehensile metal hand and arm that he had made. As far as I was concerned, he was always already a brilliant and perhaps mad scientist. In the early 1980s, I remember him showing me the first online multi-user dimensions, or dungeons. He explained how people were participating from anywhere and everywhere, and he lit up as he described this idea of online distributed networks. It was the early internet. Mike got it. He was excited about it, and he wanted to share. And he included me in that, which I always appreciated. He was one of the first people to see the possibilities of how this new technology could and would change our lives. Later, when he was leaving college, Mike seemed to be grappling with how he wanted to make his mark on the world. He was looking to see where the path that he was on was going to take him. Again, he was ahead of most of us in thinking about what was coming. He had had to invent his major, as we already heard. He called it cognitive science to describe these interests he had in mapping out human and artificial intelligence and the intersections of humans and technology. Around 1984, I remember Mike was an early fan of Apple computers. One holiday, he came to visit the family, and I remember he came off the plane with this large box-shaped carrying case. Inside was the 128 kilobyte Macintosh, which came with a funny thing called a mouse. He extolled its features and he described how personal computers were going to change everything. And he was right. As Samantha mentioned, we played hours of Dungeons of Doom. We also played Balance of Power, other games on that cool little machine. But Mike wasn't captive to computers and technology. He was wonderfully social. And as we already heard, he could talk with almost anyone about almost anything. When I was about to head off to college in 1990, he slipped me one of his 3x5 note cards that he was already using. And on there were 10 rules for surviving and thriving in my new world. Talked about how to balance friends and studying. But most of all, I remember that the rules were written with style. Mike had clearly seen a thing or two, and I was going to be the beneficiary of his adventures written down on that little card. So to me, that was Mike as the young pirate captain, at least in my eyes as an 18-year-old. He was the smartest guy in the room most of the time, but he also drove a cool Datsun 280ZX, rear-wheel drive pocket rocket, tinted windows, and a stereo that was pumping out Steely Dan, Dire Straits, and Steve Miller. He knew how to enjoy life, and I got to share some of those adventures, and again, I'm just so grateful. Of course, Mike was so much more multifaceted than whatever I understood when I was 18. He had already become a father in 1981. He and Joanna kept building their family into the 1980s until they had six kids. I'm not sure I've seen anyone work harder in those years than Mike did, except for Joanna, of course, that is. Actually, on that note, I have to say also how much I learned from Mike and Joanna working together as a team. I also saw how much he learned from her and how she made him a better person. Mike just wasn't Mike without Joanna. back to Mike. So he's a full-time father, a student, a worker, and I just saw him pour energy into every aspect of his life. Perhaps as a result, he also had the best stories about the worst jobs. Circus carny, pickle factory worker, Chinese food cart operator, and many, many more. Fast forward over time, over years and decades, Mike, it seemed to me, and he did, he grew into this person that he had chosen to become. Smart, wise, warm, funny, and just an incredible innovator. As the 1990s reached their midway point, he made the brave decision to form his own company, work on his own, become the captain of his own ship, and seek out Terra Nova. And it worked. In 1995, he co-founded Archetype Interactive with Steve, as Steve talked about, to produce the world's first massively multiplayer online role-playing game, Meridian 59. And I'll always remember and admire the way Mike's creative vision led to something completely new. And over the years that followed, it became an incredibly popular kind of gaming, and he saw it. And then over the years that followed, Mike did more and more in the world of gaming, usually pushing the boundaries of the industry. He pioneered social networks, developed personality assessment tools, created artificial intelligence engines that gave online agents hearts and brains. He was always doing something new while pursuing those original goals that he had of understanding the intersection of human thought and human emotion with technology. Then he and Joanna moved to Indiana. Looking back, it seems natural that Mike would graduate from making games to teaching the craft to the next generation of designers. I just loved hearing him share about his new undertaking and see him in his new persona, this professor of practice. To me, it seemed like he had never been happier in a professional sense than when he spoke about teaching students and developing this course program that would do right by them. I know that he worked very hard at it, but to me, he was a natural. Skimming through that incredible systems design textbook, it feels like I'm in a conversation with Mike. It's great to hear his voice, and it leaps from the pages. But then cancer came. And Mike, the one with an answer always at his fingertips, he couldn't remember things. How cruel. It was hard on Mike, of course, but one of his final gifts to me, and I think to many of us, was his serenity. In the face of that disease that took him slowly away from us, he was calm and wise and at peace, at least when he engaged with me. And there were good moments during that last year, too. Throughout that time, to the very end, on our weekly calls and our other chats, the old Mike would flash through. His insight, his humor, random facts brought together at the end. I don't have a good end to this story except to say how proud I am of Mike. How blessed I've been to have him as a brother. How much I loved him. And how lucky I am to have had him in my life for as long as I did. As short a time as that was, I'll miss him, remember him, and do my best to share these memories and so many others with everyone else who knew him and cared about him as all of us did. Thanks.
I'm Vanessa. I'm the second to youngest child of Mike's. Growing up, my siblings and I would use the criminal law term statute of limitations to describe how long we should wait until telling our parents a story that was both amusing and would have gotten us in trouble if they'd known about it at the time. After I graduated high school, Dad and I took a very long road trip from Austin, Texas to Provo, Utah to take me to college. And it was at this point that I decided the statute of limitations was up on some of my more questionable escapades I had gotten up to in high school. We talked and laughed about some of my more academically dangerous stories, and then he filled me in on a few of his own from his college years, all while making the note that I absolutely should not mimic these stories. At one point, nearing the end of a semester, Dad had looked over all the work he had to do and calculated that he had about 48 hours of work and only 24 hours to complete it in. So, and this was a lesson he imparted to me, he had to decide where to cut corners. And I'm sure everyone who is a student or has been a student knows that feeling. There are places to cut corners. One of the assignments was a lab book that he was supposed to have been filling out over the course of the semester, which he had not been doing. This is the point he reminded me to not follow in his footsteps. This warning went unheeded. He figured that there was no way his professor was going to go through every page of every student's lab book, so that was a corner to cut. He wrote a few legitimate-looking pages at the front and then filled the rest of the lab book with complete nonsense. He even considered drawing a little picture of Mickey Mouse with a speech bubble saying, "If you're reading this, hi," but he didn't want to push his luck. But sure enough, when he got his lab book back after grading, it had nothing but a red check mark on the first page showing a pass on what had turned out to be nothing but a completion grade. Another time, near the end of another semester, he was working in the building that housed the computer lab, where many students were typing away at their final papers late into the night while a thunderstorm raged outside. Suddenly, a lightning bolt struck the building, knocking out all the power. There was a moment of silence, and then a chorus of screams emanated from the computer lab from all the many students who hadn't saved their work before the outage. This was one experience that led to Dad's mantra, "Save early and save often." Another one that I've not always heeded. Dad had the ability to impart wisdom in many ways, both in serious heart-to-heart conversations and humorous memories. Most importantly, he was always happy to give it, even if it included a lesson on cutting corners.
And I'm Justin, the second oldest, after Samantha. And I'm supposed to be speaking for, as best I can, all of us kids. Ask them to funnel ideas to me. Let me get this up. There's a post online, a funny post I saw, and I thought, oh, I need to start my remarks with this. It's become a bit of a meme online. It's an intended retort to a type of person who styles themselves as an alpha. It's a thing people do. It's kind of weird sometimes, but it's kind of common. And so this post was tired of this. And so it was shooting back at people who claim to be alphas, and it declared, quote, "No, you're not. You're a jerk that thinks talking over people makes you important. Do you even know what an alpha does? They feed and protect their pack. Where's your fanny pack full of cheesy crackers?" Unquote. The post then adds, quote, "If you're out with your buds and you don't have ibuprofen, Neosporin, and cheesy crackers with you, then you are not an alpha," unquote. Now, it didn't matter where my dad, Mike, was. It didn't matter whether he was among friends, colleagues, employees, his own children, or brand new acquaintances. He always had his figurative fanny pack full of cheesy crackers and cheesy jokes at the ready. He made people feel safe and taken care of right away. And when times got tough, he made it clear that he was going to put himself on the line, like we've talked about, to make it easier for those that he considered to be under his care. And times were often tough. And so often that's the way life goes for us, but especially so when you're passionately intent on building something new. Like, for example, trying to get your latest game-breaking game idea off the ground. And so I grew up seeing both how guilty my dad often felt about the hardships that his startups would cause, both for his family and for the families of his partners and employees, as well as seeing how dedicated he was to sacrificing whatever he had to in order to do his best to make things as good as he could for all the people he considered to be under his care. He learned to have a very full and well-prepared figurative fanny pack. This meant that he couldn't afford to rest in comfortable simplifications on any side of any issue, situation, conflict, or course of action. In order to take care of the real needs of real people, he had to get beyond what he thought he already knew. Now, I'm not going to stand here and pretend that my dad was perfect at any of these things, but I saw how much he always tried. He really wanted to see more sides of everything he could. He desperately wanted to be there and provide for friends and coworkers who had put their trust in him or in his ideas. And as I watched his parenting of us kids and his leadership of his friends evolve over the years, I saw how he adapted to find whatever really would best help people in the long run, rather than whatever might, say, quickly resolve a conflict or placate a troublemaker, and certainly more than whatever might just make him look good. And in the process, he got to enjoy doing what he'd already always wanted, to become ever more of a Renaissance man. A bit of a walking paradox in some ways, it seemed, exploring as many sides as he could of every aspect of life. And so he became a safer, ever more multifaceted place for everybody that he interacted with. He was as comfortable in a tux or a double-breasted suit as he was in his beloved Hawaiian shirts. And he had a way of making the most casual clothing seem respectable, and the most formal clothing disarmingly casual. He loved talking about complex science in one moment, and then classic fantasy the next. And all the while, he reassured everybody just by enjoying what he was doing, even if that meant by doggedly enjoying the humor in tiring or silly situations. He had this constant admiration for fictional heroes who would slog on, dirty and weary, but who still managed to crack a smile and reassure others that they still had fight left in them. And whether that fiction was tantalizingly well-researched realism, like the Aubrey Maturin books, or daringly imaginative fantasy, or sometimes the rare mix of both, he always wanted to emulate this enduring good humor he wanted to emulate what he found in these fictional stories in his real-life struggles. He didn't limit himself on what he could apply, what he could enjoy, or what he could learn to understand. And he loved learning to excel at as many things as he could. But he strongly believed in always having something that you're doing that you're lousy at. And this is apparently one of his reasons for wanting to learn to surf. Because it didn't come naturally to him, didn't come easy, like so many other things did. He loved to use his abilities to try to better the world and help others, but he was also so intent on keeping himself humble. So in some ways, so much of his career seemed, at least at first, to be kind of a daunting paradox. How to make games while helping people. Because we've all heard, we all know people say sometimes games can indeed be life-choking, time sinks. But he wanted to explore how they could edify, how they could teach, inspire, how they could raise profound and applicable questions and ideas. He wanted to break beyond these sorts of common, comfortable simplifications of video games as a detrimental vice. He wanted to explore new horizons of how this ancient concept of games could be put to unprecedented beneficial use in new modern ways. So whether from simple card games to vast MMOs or any conceivable mixture in between, he pursued this supposed paradox of beneficial gaming in a way that's now forged this whole new foundational frontier for so many now to build on. Even early in his career, like we've heard, he applied the seemingly unrelated field of medicine, and particularly neuroscience, to the design of AI. He eagerly explored all he could about what games demonstrated and illuminated about psychology and about sociology, and about how the boundaries of the world as we know it might be bent. And over, his enthusiastic exploration of such apparent paradoxes led to exciting new insights, which then sent ripples of ideas flying outward among those he worked with. This willingness of his to break beyond the common simplistic attitudes led him to signify hope more and more to everyone he interacted with. Hope that there are solutions. And so often it seems like there's just not, especially when trying to troubleshoot something. Hope that things can be better, that life itself can be troubleshooter, life itself can be better. Hope that when both sides of every issue seem sometimes unacceptable, there still can be far more exciting answers in those seeming paradoxes that break beyond the simplifications. Because sometimes hope seems to fall into ever shorter supply when we feel like the only options available to us seem like opposite competing extremes. And he didn't look for solutions in the halfway happy middle ground between extremes. No, he looked for the unexpected, the unconventional paradoxes that defied both extremes while seeking the best of both worlds. And that's where, over and over, my dad found his personal principles of how he discovered life and happiness and eternity itself to function. And yet, the more he developed his personal principles, the less he saw any need to push them on anybody. And to some, that might seem paradoxical, at least at first, but to him, it was just the natural and inevitable application of how he found reality to work. So he never had to rule out anybody or their point of view. He never had to or wanted to portray anybody as an enemy. And again, I'm not wanting to suggest that he was perfect at these things, and I feel like I should be honest. I often feared that I was close to someone he might consider to be a dangerous person with dangerous beliefs. And yet, for what it's worth, I learned early when I was a teenager that I could all too easily upset my dad if I questioned too overtly someone that he looked up to, like, for instance, Stephen Hawking or something. And yet, even back when we would have these nerdy shouting matches at the dinner table about ridiculous things like the nature of light or momentum, he would still work hard to much more quietly teach me how important it was to seek peace and understanding rather than simply seeking to stand for what I might think to be correct. Now, he did stand, often quietly, sometimes grumpily, for what he believed, but he also always did his best to keep things relaxed, to be genuine, to be a welcoming and safe place for people of vastly different worldviews and attitudes as much as he could. Even science's more conservative friends would worry that he was too liberal for them, or his more liberal friends at the same time would worry he was too conservative. He enjoyed trying to be adapting and accommodating, seeking to learn without throwing out what he believed. And in order to learn like that, he had to be willing to be wrong. It's hard to troubleshoot problems in programming and design or in life otherwise. So in some of our last phone conversations, I was privileged that normally he would be remarkably coherent in a lot of these conversations, even just in those last weeks. And we talk all about all sorts of early memories of his. And one that he spent a while talking about was his pursuit of his personal views cosmologically. And he talked about how as a young adult, he had been really eagerly ruthless in trying to apply rigorous logic to eternal questions. And I know that's something that a lot of us try to do. So he sought out literature from various different competing sources. Some were theistic, some were atheistic, some were aggressively against the other. But he reflected to me about how he was so disappointed that almost all these arguments, these pamphlets, this literature were just absolutely full of what he saw as logical fallacies, simplifications, assumptions that he just poked so many holes in. But he was also hopeful that he could keep taking note of all these sorts of fallacies, trying to piece things together. And he told me how disappointed he was when some friends of his showed much less of that willingness to be wrong, to admit. And so when he told me how he would sometimes point out gaping flaws in their current beliefs, and some people would just shrug and go on with whether spiritual or secular worldviews that he thought he had just shown them to be untenable, because he was so intent on finding what, if anything, actually made sense to him. And this willingness of his, this hunger to find new ways in which he was wrong, didn't mean that he accepted fallacious arguments against what he believed, but it also meant that his focus was not on trying to convince anyone to believe as he did, especially more and more as he grew. And so, for instance, when it came to the matters of the end of his mortal life, I saw how he faced it with clarity and hope, but he wouldn't want to push his reasons for such hope on anybody. And I wouldn't either. It was his desire to always be open, to always be willing to be wrong, to explore and embrace the seemingly impossible paradoxes that make reality so fantastic and so magnificently complex. Beyond any temptations of dogma or easy fallacies, it was this ruthlessly humble approach to the sheer scale and complexity of the world that yielded such a natural result of hope, of peace, of comfort and optimism. Even these last months, even in the face of a devastating, rapid, and such a disappointing end to his many ambitions that he had for life. He knew through his careful exploration that he had everything personally to look forward to, even as he struggled with the loss of his memory. But yet his thoughts were always on making sure that those of us he left here would be okay. On the phone, he would repeatedly laugh to me about how overwhelmed he was about not being prepared to go back and teach his students, and this was long after he was no longer able to do so, and he didn't remember it. But he was still so focused on them, so worried. And when my mom reassured him that yes, they were still together after everything, he just cried. When she told him she still loved him and wanted to help him in return. He didn't live through anybody else, and he had hope for himself looking ahead, but he lived for us all. And so he'd often tell me that from a young age, he'd worried that he would have to hide how quickly he got a sense for people, especially people who he could tell he was going to be close to, because he was afraid of weirding them out. And my wife, Khalees, treasures the first time that she met him. And I sometimes got the impression my dad was a little uncertain about what sort of girl I might bring home. But then when Khalees just sarcastically sassed him right out of the gate, he just laughed and laughed and seemed to be relieved and said he knew she was going to fit right in. But it wasn't just his beloved daughters-in-law who benefited from his keen discernment of character. I hope it's okay to say that, in my opinion, he often seemed to have a much bigger crush on Caleb than Vanessa did. Right away. And yet the first time Caleb visited, my dad he'd been all prepared to have this talk with them and tell them to slow things down a bit. But then upon seeing them, he let his discernment of people prove him wrong. And he told them later that he could quickly tell that, no, they're going to be just fine. And long before that, when, according to legend, Jonathan had gone around telling his coworkers to stay away from the boss's daughter, all while he set about making his moves, my dad fortunately had the clarity to let himself see what a good man and great husband Jonathan would be. And he even nudged him toward marriage when many other men might understandably struggle with letting their child go. And I've said it twice, I'll say it one more time. I'm not mean to suggest my dad, Mike, was perfect at any of these things. If I did, I'd be ignoring how hard he worked to grow, like John was talking about, and how much he succeeded at that ambitious goal of growing all throughout his full and diversified life. And so I think the great, courageous paradox of my dad in this dogged determination he had in the face of his own flaws is kind of summed up in what's become, among our family, a kind of classic tale, the time he taught me about knife safety. They know where this is going. There my dad was. He was fully decked out in his Scoutmaster, his Boy Scout Scoutmaster uniform, which he had worked very hard to earn by seeking out intensive training. And he was standing, as I recall, in his bedroom with a fairly large knife. And we were getting ready for some scouting activity, probably scout camp. And he wanted to use the moment to teach me some sage pointers about knife safety. He had just begun to say something like, "Now, Justin, you never want to do this with a O." And suddenly he was bleeding. A lot of blood. And so he had to rush to the emergency room to get stitches, still decked out in his Scoutmaster uniform, while the nurse is trying to giggle too much at the irony. So even when he impaled himself on his own swords, even when he tripped, when he misjudged, or when he worried so often that he'd failed himself or others, he'd crack some reassuring cheesy joke and battle on. Selfish he certainly was not. And so with his figurative fanny pack always full to bursting for others, yet often still afraid it could never be enough, he did his personal best. And I think, in the end, I think that's the best thing that anyone can ever have said about them. He did his best to blaze a better trail for anyone who was willing to take it. His best to become the person that he always wanted to be. And he did his best to leave life better for everybody he could. So I hope that all of us never lose the sharp, warm memory of his reassuring smiles. of Mike's comforting presence and of his sincere and well-earned wisdom, which we've talked so much about today, but not nearly enough, and which was mixed, as always, with his open, loving silliness. I hope it's all right to say that as for myself, just for me, I don't feel like my dad is gone at all, and that's just me. I hope I'm not out of line in saying that to me, I think he seems so much happier, young, active, and more himself than he could ever be in the limitations here. But again, that's just me. But I hope that however we each now go forward, I hope we can bring his memory with us to be happier and stronger for letting him to be part of our lives. That we can each seek to emulate his constant example of patiently lifting everyone we can with his own personal versions of cheesy crackers, cheesy jokes, warm smiles, and maybe a little piratey smirk along the way. So I'm just so forever inexpressibly grateful for the impact my dad has had on my life and on all of ours here. And I can only hope to try to convey that gratitude for all the love that he showed us and hope that we can continue to show that love to him by following his example. And I don't know what else to say, but I love you, Dad, and I'm so, so grateful. And I think we're all going to continue his legacy. Thank you.
Thank you to the family for sharing that moment with us. That was wonderful. Following the closing remarks by President Jason Francis, we'll have a closing hymn, God Be With You Till We Meet Again, that can be found in the hymnal in the front of the seat. Hymn number 152, verses 1 and 2, after which the closing prayer will be provided by Calise Sellers. And then following that closing prayer, it is asked that the audience can remain seated for the last remaining musical offerings.
Thank you all for your attendance and participation this evening. Beautiful music and beautiful remarks. It's a privilege to be asked to participate in this memorial service. Members of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints are accustomed to wearing a lot of different hats, and my involvement tonight is an example of that. As a leader in the church, I have a responsibility to, the church that's hosting this service this evening, I have a responsibility to preside and make sure that the service conforms to church policy. But I've also been invited here by Joanna to and asked to share some brief reflections as a colleague and friend of Mike's. And I hope you'll just forgive a little bit of context, just because most of my experience with Mike was through our service together in the church. And so that's just, I feel privileged to be able to represent that part of his experience. One of the notable features of this church is its lay ministry, meaning that we don't have a paid minister or pastor, but church members volunteer some of our time to pitch in and help fulfill specific assignments. Almost everyone in the church has some kind of assignment to teach or to lead. We call that a calling, and we typically have one of these callings for a few years at a time before being assigned to do something else. For us, it's a sacred experience to receive and serve in a calling, and leaders pray for and about those who are going to serve and seek inspiration from heaven before extending those callings to us. Because of this dynamic, friendship among church members are often pretty different than in other circumstances. We get thrown together and become acquainted in the context of our church service. This is the case for Mike and me. We became acquainted soon after the Sellers moved to Bloomington. I was serving as a state clerk at the time, and he was called as the stake and men's president. I came to know him first as a man of wisdom and humble patience, a great teacher, and enthusiastic in his love for other people and the Lord. That's what I knew about him long before we talked about the other kinds of things that friendships are normally built on. I think we'd known each other for several months before he even mentioned what brought him to Bloomington or his professional experience. I met and developed a respect and love for him because of his personality and characteristics long before I knew of his genius or why the rest of the world might expect me to admire and respect him. Later, through a series of cosmic coincidences, we became colleagues in the media school, and I saw him exemplify those same qualities of high competence, of course, tempered with patience, kindness, and desire to nurture as he interacted with his students and peers. Another feature of service in the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints is that decisions are made by common consent. When a person receives a new calling, the members of the congregation are asked whether or not they will support that decision. The promise that we make and the verb that we use as we raise our hands to indicate that support is to sustain, meaning that we will support and strengthen them to keep them alive as they struggle and muddle through trying to figure out and perform well in that new assignment. That's the word that comes most immediately to my mind when I think of my interactions with Mike Sellers. He was always sustaining, always providing sustenance. He offered encouragement when I needed it, help when I felt overwhelmed, a kind word or a joke when it was most needed. He inspired me to try to reciprocate in kind, and to me, that seems like a beautiful basis for any friendship. I remember vividly exactly where I was sitting and precisely how I felt when I heard that Mike had passed away. I was attending a family reunion in Arizona in a room crowded with family members who were playing games and telling jokes and enjoying each other's company. As soon as I saw the text announcing the news, the room closed in around me. I felt gutted and saddened. and more than a little frustrated that we wouldn't get more time with him. It might be tempting to wonder in a moment like that, when we are surprised and shocked by what seems like a tragedy, why bad things happen to good people. But I don't think entertaining that question is ever a very fruitful exercise. Nor is it healthy to ruminate on regrets or missed opportunities. I believe in and worship a God who has a plan for Mike Sellers that began long before he was born and continues long after his death. God's plan is fundamentally about instruction and connection and progression and family, principles so beautifully embodied by this dear friend. And God's plan is also deeply personal and also universal. And as much as I miss Mike, I'm excited for the next chapter of my friend's experience. Since his passing, I've had a chance to reflect on some sacred experiences that we've had together. And I can testify with full confidence that because of the atonement of Jesus Christ, we will see and hold and hug our friend and family member again. He and his dear wife and family will be united again. The Apostle Paul taught about a trio of Christ-like attributes that invite us back into the presence of God. Faith in Christ means trusting our Savior and his promises. Hope is the belief that his promises might actually apply to us and those that we love. And charity is his love, Christ's love, that we feel as we serve our Heavenly Father's children in Christ-like ways. I'm grateful to know a friend who, through his actions and words, manifested trust in Christ, who is willing to express confidence in the covenants he had made with God, and who generously shared a Christ-like love with those he met. God be with you till we meet again, my dear friend. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen.
Our Father in heaven, we're grateful that we could meet this day to celebrate a truly powerful life of Mike and what he meant to all of us, what he ongoingly means to all of us. And we're so grateful for him and for the effect he had on each of us, for the so many lives that he touched that I'm sure he didn't even know how many lives. Please strengthen us all in the wake of his passing. Please help us to, as has been talked about, take the example of all these things that he strove for in his life and try and apply them in our own, and try to enjoy this beautiful world which thou hast given to us and make the most of it, as he always did. Please help us all with comfort at this time, especially Joanna. And please guide us and direct us that we may help each other and go forward in all our own individual endeavors and help bring peace and love to this world. We're so grateful for families and loved ones that thou hast given to us, and for Christ and his example of love. And please help us to truly be there for each who needs it, and guide us on our own personal paths in this beautifully systematic universe that we have. Thank thee again for Mike and for the time we had with him. I say this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you. thank my brother-in-law, George, for playing music and all the family and friends that have been here. And this is a slideshow, and we'll probably put on the music again for those of you who want to listen, but we can also, we've already had the closing prayer. We can have some time to just visit amongst ourselves and greet all of you. Where did Brother McMullen go? Oh, there you are. So you can put the sound back on so we can visit. All right. And I want to thank you and especially thank God for somewhat heavily-handedly getting Mike and I together and our wonderful life together and all the people that we've been able to be blessed to know. Go ahead and this runs about a half an hour. You're welcome to watch it. You can also chat amongst yourself, and we're so thankful for everybody who came.
still don't know where.